Do it, she says, her voice heavy. Find the Jahk. Bring me the answers. You focus on a device and you feel something tugging at your mind. Here we go. Everything is wrong. Tasha's body, yours now, this is cool, clings like a wet cloak. The world is too bright for nighttime. Everything is too clear. Distance is too close, edges too sharp. Memories like blood flies buzz about your head, whizzing away before you can catch them. Hand-ridden Anine heave their flanks and huff behind you. Like you, they've gone too long without rest. And there's Matkina, a much newer Matkina, as drawn by a pandering portraitist. Too soft, too fresh, too pretty. All wrong. On the waste you see the light of campfires, and in the humble village before you, a bigger, brighter fire burns. Now, does this do anything? No, it's just showing me. Okay. It's a pyre. Inside, this goes up. Inside, a body that's too large burns too slowly. Greasy coils of smoke rise into the night. Villagers circle the bonfire, waiting and shaking. The headman's rough voice continues the ritual. From exile, you are released. Among the mourners, some echo. You are released. He throws a handful of powder into the fire, metal salts, perhaps, and a spray of shining embers rises into the night, mostly gold, some green, some purple. From wrath, you are released, they echo him. As the embers float out towards the plains and fade among the stars and campfires, you hear Matkina whisper reverently, you are released. I want to... How do I... Is there... Oh, okay. I'll use a perception. Stare at the distant campfires and try to see what they are. I don't have a lot of intellect. Oh, I didn't even notice a change. You squint your unnatural eyes and focus until the pyre, the village, everything else fades away. At last the blurry campfires resolve into something crisper. And you see the faint shadows of men around them, men in long coats and broad hats, painstakingly cleaning their jazails and daggers. I don't know what a jazail is. There are perhaps 100 of them. Matkina sees you staring and grunts, Sand Knights. From her tone, it's obvious they are no friends of hers or yours. Try to remember who you are and why you're here. The memories buzz, and in the sound are flickers of meaning. This body is... You are Tash. You're a soldier under the command of someone named Paj Rekin. You're a castoff who can use the tides to destroy memories. You were sent here for some thing, an object, but exactly what, you can't recall. There's something more to it, something insistent, important, and endlessly elusive. No matter how hard you try, it becomes no clearer. Matkina, listen to me. We need to find the Jahk and protect your memories. Find the what? Matkina stares at you, dumbfounded, and then she shakes her head. Have a little respect, Tash. This is my home. We're here to save people I've known for years. A moment later, she adds, not to mention the only danger to memories around here is you, Tash. Try your tidal surge on me, and I'll burn those fancy eyes right out of your skull. There's a smile on her face, like this isn't the first time Tash has teased her, or that she's promised a grisly fate in response. Is this changing things? We're just supposed to observe, right? So I'm not supposed to change anything. Is it? I guess it's no harm to say what's going on here, Matkina. She answers without looking your way. Her eyes are locked on the fire and the flesh inside it. It's what they do when one of the hill people dies. Never a burial, always upward. Plains people like me, we can bring kindling and weep, but we're forbidden to join the chant. After a pause, she adds, I never got used to the smell of it. Even when they burnt juniper or balsam, it's worst at the end. She shrugs. When it's done, there's no more wailing. For them, it really is a release. She looks thoughtful, but says no more. I'm not supposed to change anything. So I'm going to wait until the ritual is finished. This is changing something as well. Am I supposed to talk to her? I'm going to wait. As the body burns and the mourners chant, you wait in the shadows at the edge of the village. At last, the corpse is consumed and the headman gives a final cry. To the distant dark, you are released. The villagers echo him, then drift away, leaving him alone beside the smoldering pyre. Matkina, with a hiss and a gesture, leads you over. He sniffs the air around at the sound of your approach, and with a brief smile calls out, "Kina!" His eyes are large, milky marbles. He puts hands on her shoulders. You return in unpleasant times. She touches his cheek. I return because the times are unpleasant, Ning. Without another word, the three of you leave from the fire and enter Ning's dark hut. Ning's home is humble and small, hardly furnished and wholly undecorated. On entering, he lowers his weary bulk onto a hassock and gestures towards similar cushions for you and Matkina, then begins without preamble. They hung him from a tree, old Garib, took their daggers to him, called it pruning. Blind to others' expression, he has become oblivious to his own, and he wears his pain and anger nakedly. With a grunt, he continues, they sent him home by skimmer, along with the compact they'd made to the plains people. He waves at the crumpled sheet of paper on the floor. Tick, read it to me. Who's Tick? They promised to put an end to our menace, Kina. He shakes his head. Why? We've always paid the blood price for whatever harm we've done. You know that. They know that. Yes, Matkina says softly, but the Sand Knights won't take shins. You know that. The militia is here to help, Ning. You are who we stand for. The small, the threatened, the hunted. That's who we are, too. She takes his hand. Come away. If you tell the knights you're going, they won't force a fight. They have bigger battles ahead of them, believe me. This is our place, Kita. Sorry, guys. I've been losing my voice lately. I'm gonna take a drink. This is our place, Kina. Paj Reckon will give you a home. Trust her. Ning is silent. I definitely want to try these other options, but let's read the crumpled note. You unfold the compact sent by the Sand Knights. The writing is neat, plain, small, and seems to go on and on in tightly stacked lines. In essence, it is a vow to safeguard the villagers and towns of the Vrxulian Waste from the menace in Koln Village. The knights promise that they will undertake steps to assure that the killers in Koln Village never harm anyone again. Extermination is never mentioned, merely implied. Beneath the knight marshal's chop are signatures from various burghers, mayors, and elders of towns and villagers on the waste. The knights ask nothing in return from them. The signatures vow nothing. They merely endorse, justifying whatever the knights undertake. What happened to your eyes? Matkina gives you a hard look, but Ning merely shrugs. An accident. Long forgotten. He rubs the blind orbs with his thick, grubby fingers, then shakes his head. It is a smaller thing than you might think. You don't need to trust Paj Reckon. Just trust Kina. Ning cocks his wide head. Why would I doubt her? He smiles. There was a plains child, a beautiful boy, wandered too far into the waste and was gone. We all gave him up. But Kina? He puts his hand on her shoulder. She left that night with a knife and a lamp and a rope. Just said, I'll bring him back. Hardly spoke back then, Arkina. Made things easier. A week later she comes back, the boy riding her shoulders, a string of Cherog heads dragging behind her. He fixes his blind eyes upon you. When she speaks, I trust. But even if Paj Reckon sets land aside for us, we can't just leave. It's not so simple. Plains people can't understand. What is it that we can't understand? For a long moment, Neng turns his blind gaze back and forth between you and Matkina. What it means to be a hill person, he says at last. What it's like to wrap yourself in chains every day. But maybe I'm an old fool. You're not the Kina who left, and you, stranger, he trails off. You're soldiers. Maybe you've started to understand what it's like to hold yourself back. Matkina's answer is sharp. Neng, all my life I've had to restrain myself, but not in the militia. It's freedom. Neng, the freedom of knowing that what you're doing is right, so you don't need to hold back. The old man shrugs. Then I was right. You can't understand. Have you ever seen anywhere other than this village? It's not exactly paradise. No. No, it's not paradise. And no, I've never left. As I said, it's not so simple. He scratches at his chin and seems about to say more, then checks himself, and after a moment he does speak, but it seems as if he has changed the subject. Years ago, a peddler passed through Colne Village, selling moving pictures of cities he had seen, the teeming harbor of Sega's Cliffs, the spires of Zakarl, the glittering oasis of Amargolios. But among all the places, there was none that there would be home. There was none that would be home. He shrugs. But you're surely right, so that they're no worse than these rocks. Neng, there are a few hundred sand knights camped a few hours' ride from here. You need to make a decision. Neng nods slowly. You're right, of course, even if you've got the manners of a marauder. After a minute, he turns his blind eyes to Matkina. But we can't go without the Jahk. The what? Matkina asks. Up the hill, behind the gate. The cave's been sealed for generations. Inside is the Jahk. It's what helps us keep our worst instincts inside. If we leave its song... He trails off, gesturing to the pyre outside. After a pause, he leans in, whispers in Matkina's ear. Now, he says, you alone of the plains people know how to open the gate. You work your way up the terraced hillside, leaving Neng to make his case to the people... or to his people. In the distance, you see that the Sand Knights are on the move, riding hard toward Colne Village. Neng will need to make his case to them, too. When you gesture at the cave, and its huge ancient gateway, Matkina shakes her head. For years I wondered about this. The hill people tell a fable that the first men and women came out of here. They said the gate would only open when it was time for people to disappear. She shrugs. One way to keep kids from poking around and disturbing the Jahk, I guess. Something she said stirs your mind, and your memories jingle like a wind chime. Try to dredge up the memory that was troubling you, anamnesis. I don't have intellect right now. Failure. The more you try to focus on the uneasiness, the more diffuse it becomes, like a fog that turns all the sounds, haunting, and even friendly shapes into nightmares. You're sure there's something awful hidden in that fog, but it seems as if you'll never find it. What exactly are these hill people, Matkina? My family. She sighs and taps her foot impatiently, impatient with herself, it seems, because she soon rushes forward. An Aeon priest named them Teratomorphs. But they don't use that name or any other. They've lived here, on this hill, for ages. They protect any plains people who sought shelter in Colne Village. She swallows, closes her eyes, and makes a decision. They're not human. Sometimes they change, go wild. Usually it happens to the young, the old. People in other villages call it skin changing, and they call the hill people monsters. She shakes her head. It passes, and they change back, but sometimes they leave the village and never turn back. They lose control. People get hurt. With a protective edge in her voice, she finishes, Family. That's what they are. Family. People. Gesture toward the gate. After you. Matkina shrugs and quickly disarms the dozen ancient locks that have long kept the cavern sealed. With a gasp, the gate opens, and without waiting, she steps through. You follow. What you find within is no cave tunnel. In fact, there's no stone at all. Rather, it's a smooth hallway made of greenish, phosphorescent ceramic. Under its glow, you and Matkina take on the look of the unburied dead. There seem to be no side passages, no chambers, merely a single path that curls ever inward like you are in the shell of some great nautilus. From time to time, the walls are adorned with lifeless ciphers, arcane charts, even scorch marks as if from a struggle. They tell no tale for you to hear. At last you reach the tunnel's end, and there on a pedestal before you is what must be the Jahk, a kind of reed flute that plays an endless, formless song, at once almost too faint to hear and too haunting to bear. Whether the music is caused by the breeze blowing through the tunnel or by the Jahk itself is impossible to determine. The ceramic pedestal beneath it, alone of all the devices in the cave, still pulses with living energy. That energy causes the Jahk to float a fraction of an inch in the air. It doesn't rest on the pedestal so much as hang above it. So, says Matkina, here it is. Examine the Jahk in its pedestal. While the Jahk and the wistful wind-blown notes is what you came for, it is the pedestal that draws your attention first. Hidden within, some secret mechanism holds the Jahk aloft, untouched and motionless. As you ponder its workings, you notice something else, a trap. Nestled below the Jahk is a serrated ring, and tiny, ugly bolts of energy leap from tooth to tooth, ready to surge if their field is disturbed. Or mystical for this part? Or for the following? As for the Jahk, you get the sense there is more than the music to mere wind over pipes. Not just tones beyond your hearing range, but that perhaps forces beyond sound itself, a deeper harmony that resonates in more than the tiny bones of the inner ear. We need to disarm this thing. I'm not going to ask her if you're going to take it, because she's going to take it and set off the trap, right? What do you think this place is? Matkina shrugs. It could be anything. You're the one who always says a person will go crazy trying to understand the world. But from the way she holds a little breath in as she ends the sentence, it's clear that she can't stop there. Crazy or not, she wants a meaning to it. I think the hill people must have come from here, or maybe come through here. She shrugs again. But we're not here to find answers. We're here to get that. She points at the Jahk. All right, let's try to disarm this trap. Speed. Okay, we'll use it all. Since we're low on intelligence anyway, we're going to have to rest soon. Success! The pedestal's machinery is alien, unholy novel to you, but that is true of nearly every cipher and artifact in the Ninth World. The key is to stop grasping for the familiar, to stop seeking an underlying logic, and simply to accept the thing before you on its own terms. With a hard eye and a delicate touch, you tame the device and disarm its trap. The Jahk stops floating and bangs twice, first against the pedestal, then against the ceramic floor. Matkina shakes her head in mock disgust, then picks it up. We've got what we wanted, she says, and gestures back down the way you came. Let's go. What the hell's going on here? They're waiting for you at the gate. A woman you immediately know to be Paj Rekin and her bodyguard. A half-dozen tattooed cast-offs with drab armor, mismatched weapons, and the languid readiness of predators. Past them, in the village below, you see the Sand Knights have arrived and are a meeting with Neng and the villagers. Without warning, one of the bodyguards lowers his weapon at Matkina and fires, but she's already moving and takes a glancing blow. A knife is in her hand as another glaive aims a new device. Before Matkina can fling her blade, she's frozen, trapped in shimmering energy. Behold. Pash herself aims a tiny cipher at the Jahk. The others watch, paying you little mind. What are you doing? As you try to speak, Paj raises her empty hand, and such is the force of her will that you fall silent. Without pausing, she activates the cipher she's holding in her other hand, and a thin beam shoots forth. The Jahk simply disintegrates. Oh well, guess I should have ran or fought or something. In the village, chaos explodes. Where once Neng and his hill people stood, there's now a writhing mass of tentacled things which fall upon the Sand Knights. The sorrow? Caught off guard, a dozen knights die instantly. Others open fire. Inside the energy field, Matkina trembles with rage, her burning eyes flicking between you and Paj. Paj sighs. This is an unfair way to reward friends, but one must secure victory and make amends later. She points to the slaughter below. Those Sand Knights are irreplaceable. With a single stroke, we've shifted the balance of power in the Vexulian Waste and loosened our enemy's iron grip from 24 villages. You've served the militia well. Let Matkina go. Of course, Paj answers, as we planned, but first wipe her mind. Then we release her, and we see whether she finds her way home to us, where she belongs. That should be within your power, within Tash's power anyway. When the tides surge through him, he can destroy memories, the same way you use the tides to escape the sorrow in your mind. But for all you've become accustomed to wearing his body, you feel no special attunement to the tides, no sense of power over others' memories. In fact, within this mirror, you hardly feel the tides at all. Deception. I don't have any skill in deception. And plus that uses intelligence, of which I have none. You can't treat Matkina this way. I won't help you. Paj shakes her head. This isn't the Tash I know. She steps forward, not to threaten, but to shrink the gap between you. I ask too much of you. I know it's hard to see a friend, a partner, as an abstraction. She shakes her head. We're fighting for our existence, Tash, for our dream. Not each for her own life, her own whims, for our collective lives, our shared goal. We have to stand together, shoulder to shoulder, and hold the line. I've heard the same voice you're hearing, Tash, telling you to trust your heart. Do what you know is right. It sings beautifully, and nothing feels as good as self-righteousness. Certainly not the satisfaction of a hard job done well. But that is the voice of pride, Tash, of selfishness, egotism. Oh, it sounds sweet, and noble, and just, but it's not. She puts a hand on your shoulder. Humility, Tash, is accepting that others know better than you, and sacrifice isn't throwing your life away, because you know it is right. That's self-indulgence. Sacrifice is doing what you know is wrong because it is your duty. She points at Matkina. How many dozens have you helped her kill? Did you think they all deserved it? I assure you, they did not. But it was necessary. So is this. A soldier who follows orders is an asset. A soldier who does not is a liability. So now I order you, soldier, destroy her memories. I'm not going to pass this deception check. I have an inability in it, and I have zero intelligence. So this would not be right. Matkina did tell us not to change things. So we're, I'm supposing, supposed to act out everything the same as it happened. So let's at least try to wipe Matkina's memories. It's a stinky thing to do, but, well, it's already happened, right? So tidal affinity. You have no idea how to wield the tides as Tash would. It's not a power that resides in his body, which you've stolen, but in his essence, which you've shunted aside. You can only try to achieve the same result by guesswork. You focus your mind and gaze upon Matkina, willing a way to wipe her memories clean. Matkina meets your stare, and her eyes have a clarity and a half-vacancy that you've seen, that Tash has seen, before she kills. She's past anger now, and come to cold revenge. But whatever wishes lie beyond your gazes, nothing happens. Nothing happens. You cannot cause a tidal surge through the mirror caster. You cannot wipe her memories. Paj looks at you impatiently. This is not the time for dallying or playing games, Tash. We need to leave before the Sand Knights finish with the villagers and turn their gaze on us. I don't think I can. Tash scowls, and her bodyguard's languor shifts ever so slightly toward action. They've no doubt learned to read her, to anticipate her will, to kill almost before she even gives the word. You can't, or you won't? She asks carefully. Can't. I can't call up the tidal surge. I would if I could. Being truthful. Pash scrutinizes you for a moment, then nods. It happens. She gestures to her bodyguards, and without a word they grab Matkina and fling her over the cliff. Is she dead? Or can she die? She's a cast-off. Like me, I can't die, right? Still trapped in her energy field, she can't even scream as she crashes into the rocks below. In the village, neither side has the upper hand, and between the monstrous hill people and the cornered sand knights, no quarter is given, and no effort is made to avoid collateral damage. It is carnage, no more, no less. It's time to go home, Pash says. The airship awaits. She gestures and leads her bodyguard away, plainly expecting you to follow. I do want to try this. It's not going to work, unless it's a really low check, right? Persuasion. Is there room for some of the villagers in the airship? To even save a few would prove we weren't liars. Yeah, we got 50% chance. Success. She sighs in exasperation. If it will make it easier for you, so be it. She herself leads the sortie down the hillside, flanked by her bodyguards, followed by you. By now the village is filled with the sharp retort of Jizales, the smoke of uncontrolled fires, and the din of screaming voices. Some inhuman, some pitiably human indeed. Neither Pash nor her followers is disturbed. Are disturbed. Pash orders you to keep watch on the path up the hill, slips a mask over her face, and disappears into the smoke with the others. A moment later she emerges, leading a handful of terrified survivors. All of you race up the hill and into the airship as the village dies behind you. You stand with Pash at the prow of her airship, looking down at the convulsing village. The Sand Knights, the 36 or so still standing, finally have the upper hand. They move in a defensive square, hurling burning brands into any building still standing and unleashing a fusillade on anyone that emerges. Only a few of the monstrous hill people still live, skulking in the smoke among the rubble. You can see them from your vantage. Perhaps they'll kill more Sand Knights before the battle's down, but whatever the final tally, it's clear that Colne Village is gone, and Matkina, lying broken somewhere among the ruins, is gone too. Is she really dead? Is she going to be here in the room when we come back? Pasha's face is stoic as she looks down from the ship. Perhaps without your preternatural eyes, she can avoid seeing the individuals ground up by her gambit and can see only a strategic point and the numbers it represents in the grand strategy. Or perhaps she has simply learned to set an example to her subordinates in the militia. She sees you staring at her and gives a small smile, a generous one, if it's real, devoid of irony or cruelty. I'm proud of you, she says, and then she walks away to her cabin to plan some new battle. As she does, Tash's body slips away. His mind lets go of your own. You are falling through space once more, through space and time, falling homeward. Do we change things? Is she going to be here in the chamber with us? Let's find out.
I'm ready to learn something new.
She's still here. My dominant tide shifted. As your consciousness rises from the shadow of the mirror, something clicks in your mind. Something has changed deep inside you. But what? My dominant tides. Matkina stares at you, the shock painfully obvious on her face. What? What did you do? I remember Tash cutting me. I see the holes in my mind. I remember him forcing me to the ground, tearing out my history with his tides. But I have other memories now. They're real. Tash didn't do it. He could have, but he didn't. He tried, but didn't. He didn't touch me. Didn't violate me. But I remember his mind pushing at me, but no. She holds her head in her hands, shaking, her voice becoming thick. The two strands of memory. This is pulling me apart. She looks up at you, tears streaming down her cheeks. No, it's pulling me back together. I remember now. That hole is... it's almost gone. You changed reality. You changed it. She stands, drying her eyes with her sleeves. I don't know if you meant to do that, but you've done more than your part of the deal. You asked about the resonance chamber. I know it. Mazov's the guy you want. He can fix anything. He might have even helped design the chamber you're talking about. Your best bet is to look for him in the cast-off sanctuary. Mille Avest. Huh. There's a cast-off sanctuary? It's a sanctum, a refuge, created by the First and our sire. It's shielded from the sorrow, supposedly. She shrugs. Our siblings like to hide there, until they can't stand each other's company anymore. And she thinks, personally, I don't think anywhere is safe from the sorrow. Not even that place. Huh. Great. Where can I find Mille Avest? Word of caution. They won't believe you in Mille Avest. They'll treat you like they treat every new cast-off, as a pawn in their games with each other. Look out for that. She walks to her table and unrolls a map of the Sagus Protectorate. You're not going to find it by walking there. The entrance is a secret, known only to our kind. Here. She points to a spot on the map, many kilometers to the northeast of Sagus Cliff. The Valley of Dead Heroes. There's a hidden portal in the necropolis. Also memorize this. She writes the numbers 3431 on a slip of paper, holds it in front of your eyes for several seconds, then crumples it in her hand. I'm writing that down just in case I need to know it. It's a code. It'll make sense when you get to the necropolis. Huh. The necropolis. I just finished playing an episode of, what do you call it? Can't remember the name for some reason. Steve Jackson's Sorcery, where in the Kare, the city of traps and stuff like that, there's a graveyard called the necropolis. I fought a death wraith there. Actually, no. I escaped from a death wraith there. You'll need an airship to get to the valley. Maester Aventus? The guy we just saw. The ladder over there leads up to the caravanserai. You should be able to hire a ship without too much difficulty. Thank you. Can I ask some other questions?
I think I'm ready to try something new.